there. Welcome back to another show. Today I'm talking about three 21st century Stephen Sondheim musicals. Which basically means as there have been three films made of Sondheim musicals in the 21st century. I'm going to look at all three of those. So it's going to be Sweeney Todd, The Demon Barber, Fleet Street, there's Into the Woods, and there's West Side Story, the remake. So I watched all three in the last week or two for this video, and I'm going to talk about them. So I should state out first, there's two of them I really like, and there's one that I like that there's some problems with. The one that I had the problems with was generally one bit of casting, more than anything, and the fact that it could have done a bit more work with the script, needed a little bit more work. But the two really good ones are Sweeney Todd and West Side Story. So I'll focus them first, and then go to Into the Woods as a finale. So I'll start with Sweeney Todd, because that was the first one made. It was made by, I think it was produced by DreamWorks, Paramount, and Warner's. So it was one of those things where no one was quite sure the film would do well, because it's a musical when there was very few musicals that did well. But this one actually did pretty well. Publicity-wise, they did not advertise it as a musical, even though it's wall-to-wall musical. Basically, they sold it on the atmosphere. So the basically, people who knew what it was would know it's a musical, but people who didn't would think it's a horror movie. And it actually worked, so by the time people realised it's a musical, people had also the word of mouth getting around it was a good film, so you don't fear it. So it stars Johnny Depp, who at this point was at his peak as a movie star, directed by Tim Burton, who had a lot of hits, co-starred Helen Bonham Carter and Alan Rickman and Sacha Baron Cohen, who were all big at the time. And again, it was like split between different studios putting money in, and so basically everyone to put a little bit in and hope for the best. So nobody was going to like be made bankrupt if this film failed. Like it was a kind of low risk for everybody, comparative to other budgets at the time. So even for like a film of the time, it was a medium budget film, even though it looks like it cost a lot more. Just a case of Tim Burton knows how to make a film on a kind of medium budget if he needs to. He doesn't need a blockbuster budget. He knows how to work with technicians to create worlds that look more expensive than they are. So that's how they did it, basically. And they just used smart use of sets, which and could get redressed, and you know, careful planning on what sets they needed. So they basically took the Hammer approach. Hammer was notorious for redressing its sets and moving things around, and so that you can have the same set three times in a film, been redressed, so the theory is you'll barely notice. This film does it a lot better than Hammer did it sometimes. but it's just that thing of having people who know what they're doing, who can hide they can hide the cheats so it looks more expensive than it is. But the film was still had enough money to look professional and look like a mega budget production. It just wasn't. Like in those, even in that time, they were making films like Spider-Man 3 and the Pirates of the Caribbean films, all of which cost a fortune. And this one cost like a mere fraction of that. And it did well. It did really well. And I think the success of this one didn't lead to a renaissance, but led to like, okay, we're willing to try these Sondheim musicals once in a while. So that led to like 5-6 years later, you get Into the Woods. Another 5 or 6 years later, you got West Side Story. I'm not sure we get any more, because West Side Story, even though it was very good, didn't do very well commercially. But again, all of these films that were made were all made at a limited budget. They were never made for like the top level budget of any studio. They were always made for like the kind of mid-range budget of any studio, so it was always a case of you had to kind of scrimp and save. Even like for directors, like Spielberg had to kind of be careful with his budget for, you know, West Side Story. So I'll go back to Sweeney Todd. The actual film itself is a very dark horror movie with musical numbers. That's what the play was. That's what the kind of the setup of the play is. It's like it's a tragedy There's lots of musical numbers, there's lots of plots going around, and we follow these plots. Now, fans of the musical were a little bit sniffy because to make it a film, you have to cut stuff out and move things around. So it was like, it wasn't a full musical and all the rest of it, and Johnny Depp doesn't sing like a musical performer on Broadway. But this is made to be a film, and I've not seen the musical. I would like to, but I've not seen it. So I could just focus on, does the film work? And the film really works. The film has great power and understands what it needs to be. So that's what I'm going on. And the singing's good. I mean, it's not like... These are not like top-level singers, but they're actors singing professionally and adding character to the way they sing the songs, which means the songs feel appropriate to the characters. Some actors are more confident in their singing ability than others. So it's one of those things. Alan Rickman is not the greatest singer. He doesn't have that many songs. But he's less of a... But he's not really, doesn't really need to be. Something like Johnny Depp isn't like the greatest singer, but have you seen Cry Baby? He can carry a tune and he can make it part of the character, which he does with Sweeney Todd. The Sweeney Todd songs in this one do feel like extension of the character is after revenge, and it feels right for the film. Helen Botham Carter's the same way. Her songs feel right for that character. The kid that plays Toby, his songs feel right for that character and what happened to that character. So there's lots of well-designed musical numbers that fit in the world. There's a love story going on at the same time, which is probably the weakest part of the film, but it's still fairly dark and, you know, twisted, and so that works too. I mean, it's... That's where the film feels more like a Broadway musical compared to the rest of the film. The rest of the film's fully into what it's about, what this revenge story. Because basically the story is Sweeney Todd was originally a barber in London under a different name, under his original name. A judge falls in love with his wife and basically gets him set up for a crime and sent to Australia for apparently all time, and then Sweeney Todd comes back, he thinks his wife's dead, and he's out for revenge, and he teams up with Helen Bolton Carter's pie maker, who makes these awful pies, and slowly starts the seeds of his revenge, and during that time they kill a lot of people, make a lot of money, and they get rid of the bodies by turning them into pies, and the revenge mechanics slowly work their way through. Turns out the woman had a daughter. It was Sweeney Todd's daughter. She's now under the control of Alan Rickman's villain. The young man's in love with her, and how that kind of twisted story kind of connects with the Sweeney Todd story kind of gives the momentum to all the tragedy that unfolds. It's a really wonderful film. It's a melodrama. It doesn't even try and hide the fact it's a melodrama. It's using gothic melodrama plotting, operatic plotting. People sing their emotions. It's full on a musical. It doesn't try and be anything but a musical. It enjoys being a musical. And because it's very dark and has got all these very Tim Burton-esque kind of character designs, where everything's almost in black and white, with red being the other colour. And every so often you get a character with some colour, like the character played by Sacha Baron Cohen, who's the Pinelli, who's the kind of fake barber who was once a guy who worked for Depp before he gets thrown out. And things like that, he brings some colour to it, but generally it's full of revenge fantasies and nastiness and the cynicism of the world. And there's a hilarious bit where this poor little ginger kid gets condemned to be hung by Alan Rickman's judge, and it's like, wow, that's brutal. That's so funny, but it's brutal. And he made it the cutest kid possible, just to make it, just to, so you know that Alan Rickman's character is a total scumbag. There's a lot of dark humour, which is very Tim Burton. There's a lot of just dark, you know, motivations throughout. But it's offset by the musical numbers, which are dark in their own way, but they do have a rhythm to them. And so it creates this thing of, it's a revenge tale, it's really tragic, and as the film goes on, it gets more and more tragic. As you find out the fate of his wife and all the rest of it, which is all very much keeping in with the kind of gothic melodrama genre. And there's lots of twisty things, but also the musical numbers are so good that it kind of takes the edge off the horror. But when the horror really comes. So it's just a wonderful film. It's one of Tim Burton's best films. It's one of those ones where all his instincts come together, because with Tim Burton, sometimes you get a really good film, and other times he has lots of ideas but they haven't been cohered into one, like, proper narrative. He sometimes has too much stuff going all around and it hasn't been kind of figured out yet. So that's kind of problem with Tim Burton sometimes, is like, he's interested in some bits of the film, not all the film. And this one, he seems to have a passion for all the film, and he knows what he's wanting to do with it. Which is funny, because he followed us up by Alice in Wonderland, which is probably one of the films where he's the most fragmented and has lots of stuff that don't join up at all. But that was when he went into the period of trying to work in blockbusters for the new kind of level of studios and Disney and things like that, and it didn't work out as well for him because he wasn't as suited to that as people thought he would be. But Sweeney Todd's one of the really good Tim Burton films, one of his great films. Again, it doesn't get full appreciation for some people who say, oh, the stage musical is better, but it's like, it's not a stage musical, it's a film. I think if you just look at it as a film, you're going to enjoy it. If you like revenge dramas, dark humour, dark mythology, it's really pitch black throughout, but it is wonderful. It is my favourite of the three, but the thing with this one and West Side Story is, both of them are excellent, and your preference is probably down to what kind of story you like better, rather than, oh, one's definitely better than the other. It's much more like, okay, what kind of story do you like more? And that's probably the one you like most, but they both are good. So, West Side Story is directed by Steven Spielberg. It's a rare flop for him. It came out, everyone loved it, didn't want to see it. But because it's called West Side Story and it's a musical, and it's coming out just as the pandemic was in full force, and it was bad timing, and they never quite managed to sell the idea of this musical and how it connected people. They were trying to re-establish a musical this time into the Heights, because things like Hamilton had made a lot of money, so they thought there was going to be a new resurgence, so they put some money into these musicals and they didn't pay off. But it doesn't matter, because sometimes you get a fan, it doesn't pay off, and sometimes you get some good films out of it. And this was one of the cases with this one, West Side Story. It was a remake of a Robert Wise film, which was an adaptation of the stage play that was a big hit in the 50s. Now, Spielberg actually went back to the Broadway play rather than the actual film, because he says he respected the film, but he actually knew the music from the play rather than the film itself. So it had nods to the original film. Rita Moreno, who was one of the lead actors in the film, had a supporting part in this one, was one of the producers, but essentially he approached it as being a new adaptation rather than being a remake. So but what that meant was he could just approach it the way he wanted to approach it, from the way his instincts to the musical was, so he wasn't going to be slavishly tied to whatever like Robert Wise had done like in the 60s. So he could cast it the way he wanted to cast it, he could choreograph it the way he wanted to choreograph it, so certain songs that were placed in one part of the film originally, or in the play, he could adapt and move a little bit to suit his story. There was one sequence that was meant to be just a singing sequence where he turned a musical number while still having to singing. There's things like that he did that energized the film a lot more. It was just like, this dramatically works better. So it's basically Romeo and Juliet, but in the 50s when the there's lots of immigrants coming into New York, and as anyone knows about New York, is there's always been immigrants coming to New York, there's always been some tension. It's like, it's almost the story of the city. So this time it's the Puerto Ricans dealing with the basically the natives who had been there for a while. But the natives are made up of various cultures that integrated, and the Puerto Ricans hadn't yet. So it was just that thing. People just weren't used to each other. And the area is going to get demolished and make way for a new New York type of thing. So a lot of people who lived there are feeling like they've been thrown away by life. So the people who have lived there for a long time feel like they've been thrown away. They don't know what's going to happen, so they stick to their gangs. Meanwhile, the Puerto Ricans come in looking for a new life. They're dealing with the vestiges of the old life for the people who are left and who are bitter. And a lot of the kids who are there at the time form gangs. So it's two sets of gangs, both of them hating each other, but basically hating each other for stupid reasons that ultimately aren't going to mean anything. But they need something. And they just... It's just a bunch of guys from two different cultures that are dying for a fight to deal with their own frustrations. And that's really what it is. And that's what the film makes clear without overdoing it. Now, Spielberg sometimes can overdo the metaphor for something. Sometimes he tells you stuff. You can be implied he'll come out and say it sometimes in some of his films. This one, he just lets the situation tell you what's going on. You can figure the rest out. Also, there is a love story, the Romeo and Juliet love story about the guy and the girl. They're in love with each other from the guys have been there for years. The girls from the immigrants, and they fall in love, and they're trying to escape from the stupidity around them. Of course, they're going to get dragged back into it. There's going to be some tragedy. You know the story, basically. You can tell it's all going to go wrong, but the film is done with annoying naivety at certain points, as well as a lot of cynicism at other points. It's like the central love story, there is a nice naivety to it, but there is a sense of humour. They know there's some issues, and they're thinking either been selfish. Meanwhile, the conflict is done with a sense of humour too. It's like everybody in this conflict kind of knows why they're doing it, and they kind of know they've been selfish and they've been silly in lots of ways. So it allows for people to comment on the stupidity of the situation from both sides. But you also get the point of view of the characters and why they're doing it, and why it's almost like they've no other choice. Like for the nativist, like the Jets, basically, they are just trapped there. And they have a sense of humour about it all, and a sense of humour about the world they're in and how they've been left behind. And the Sharks are pretty much, they're the same. They've come to this country and they're homesick, and they don't know if they're going to fit in, and there's all this violence going on around them, and they have to protect their own. And it's a film about both sides and how they really need to try and get along a little bit, because there are bigger problems. And all the women characters know there's bigger problems, but all the guys, just they need a fight. And that's what the story's about. They need a fight. And that leads to tragedy. So you get a lot of songs that they've come into culture in the last 70 years that are, you know, the song, and it's like, oh, is that came from here? Oh, right. Because I'd never watched a Robert Wise film. It's a musical. Musicals for me are generally like, the musical has to be good and I'll enjoy it, but if it's not a good one, I'm not watching it. It's not the westerns. I love a good western, but I'm not going to watch the kind of mid-range ones. They're not my kind of genre. So there's things that you're going to get it. There's America. There's lots of, and as you go through the film, he's like, oh, I know this song. It's like they've been used so often that, and for other things that you know the songs. So the songs are done wonderfully. There's a terrific sequence early on where they're doing a high school Dance, and both sides come together to face off. They're facing off through dance. And Spielberg has always wanted to do a musical, so when he gets his chance, because if you see certain films like 1941 and Temple of Doom, when he gets a chance to do a musical number, he really goes for it. He's always wanted to do a musical. So when he gets a chance to do one in this film, he really goes for it. And if you see a lot of the Indiana Jones films, things like that, a lot of the action has a kind of musical tone to it. It's like it builds and builds, and there's a sense of humor to it, and there's enjoyment of the athleticism and the things happening that has more to do with the movement than the actual action. So he's always had a very musical tone to his action. So he's having a ball here, and you can just tell he's really enjoying it. The performances all around are good. I mean, Ansel Elgort as Tony got some. He gets treated the roughest in the reviews, but I thought he was good in the film. I thought he worked well. Rachel, what's her name? She's good as Maria. You've seen her in a bunch of other stuff recently. I've just blanked on her name for some reason, even though I knew it before I started the video. I'll know it as soon as I stop the video, I'll be like, oh god. All the other actors are terrific. It all works. So it's a really good film, really solid. I'd be happy to rewatch it. It really just delivers on the humour, on the dance moves, on the romance. Everything works. And again, as I say, with Sweeney Todd in this one, both are excellent. It will just depend on what kind of film you like better, really. But they're both excellent films. This one didn't do as well with Sweeney Todd. It just came at the wrong time. I don't think they knew how to sell it. When I saw the trailers, like, nah, won't bother. They just never found a way to sell this film. And I don't think, when I look back at the trailers weren't quite what the film was. It was like they were kind of ashamed of the film, because they weren't quite sure how to tell people what the film was. They never quite worked it out. And so it became a kind of slick thing that had no personality in the advertising. It was just like, you've seen the other film, please come watch this one, which is not a good way to sell a film. So now we have Into the Woods, which is another Sondheim musical, Into the Woods. This one is all about like the fairy tales, like Little Red Riding Hood, Cinderella, Jack and the Beanstalk, you know, all of these things, the Prince Charming and everything else. The witches, you know, and it's this is the one plot that connects them all, to this baker and his wife, and they're cursed by a witch because of what his father did, and they're trying to help because the witch herself has been cursed. So if they lift the curse off the witch, she will lift the curse off of them, so they can have a child at that point. And basically, the tale becomes they have to interact with these other fairy tales to try and find these objects that will lift the curse. So they interact with Little Red Riding Hood, with the Big Bad Wolf, played by Johnny Depp. The Witch is played by Meryl Streep. You've got Jack and the Beanstalk story with his cow, the lean to cow. And the giants cause havoc. You've got Rumpelstiltskin story in the background, because that's the sister of the baker. He doesn't know she's still alive. There's the Cinderella story, Cinderella played by Anna Kendrick, and Prince Charming's Chris Pine. There's all these stories floating around, and they interact with each other through the baker and his wife. Now, the baker's played by James Corden, his wife's played by Emily Blunt. And James Corden, the big problem of the film, he really is the problem of the film, because he's not that good an actor. Now, he's been in stuff, he's been fine in, like Doctor Who. When he was in Doctor Who in the small parts, he was fine. But he's such a monotonous presence in this film. They have not found a way to make him interesting, and I think it's just miscasting. His singing voice isn't that great, his presentation song isn't that great, he comes across as whiny and, you know, just self-pitying. And I mean, in a way that's, the character's meant to be worn down by life, but he doesn't feel worn down by life, he just feels like he's a whiner. That's the problem with this part, and this casting. His wife's, Emily Blunt, is going through all the same stuff, and she's got a lot of get up and go, and she's really good. And it's like one actor doing the job for two in these scenes, which is kind of sad. It's just like, how can no one see this and go, he's wrong, he's just not working? It's just that thing of a performance that just does not work. And and everyone else is good around him, which makes it worse because he just points out, oh, he's a problem. He's a problem. That becomes the issue of the film. And this thing, it sinks in him because he is the main character. He's the narrator. He's the one who it ties all around. And everyone else is a support to him. And all the supporting parts are good. Meryl Streep's having a lot of fun as a witch. She's a bit over the top sometimes, but that's fine. The part kind of needs it. The ugly sisters are over the top, and there's some brutal humor there. Prince Charming, played by Chris Pine, his brother, played by Billy Magnussen, are hilarious because Chris Pine is doing pure William Shatner. He never didn't do William Shatner at all in Star Trek, but in this one, a lot of the mannerisms are pure William Shatner. It's like he's having a ball just sending up this kind of over-stylized acting style, and it's just great. Every time he's on screen, it's funny. He's a guy who doesn't get how lucky he is, and he doesn't quite understand how his life is easy and everything else's life is horrible. He doesn't get it. It's just me, me, me. So you've all these stories floating around. The Jack and the Beanstalk story is terrific because the kid playing Jack is a lot of fun. The same way in the kid playing Tobias and Sweeney Todd, Sondheim writes good child characters, and if they get a good actor playing them, it can be a lot of fun. The kid playing Little Red Riding Hood is a lot of fun as well. So all the child performances work. And there's just lots of Anna Kendrick as Cinderella is perfect. And how the stories evolve from where you know they start and how they evolve into things that aren't quite the same as the original stories create a lot of interest, and how it's much more complicated as they're treated like these fantasy stories are treated like what happened in real life, where nothing's quite as simple as it seems. And everyone's game and everyone's enjoying it. I mean, it's not the best directed film. I mean, Sweeney Todd and West Side Story have much more distinctive directorial angles and just cutting between scenes and cutting through musical numbers and things like that. And this one, it's done well enough, but it's not distinctive. Rob Marshall, director, he did Chicago, he'd done a bunch of films and musicals, so he was meant to be the musical master. But he's a lot less distinctive than Spielberg or Tim Burton, who are not musical directors. But they find a lot more life to the musical numbers than he does. And when it comes to special effects sequences, it's just okay. There's nothing there that's astonishing in any way. It's okay. It's not incompetent, but it's not like stunningly great either. It's just like it's done well by professionals, but you kind of wish they'd see Tim Burton onto the set once or twice, to add some visual flair. It would have made it a bit more interesting. It has that just that feel of this could have been better. So that's the downside of this film. The upside is it's still an enjoyable film. The material is good. The actors are all game apart from one. And basically the material is good enough to support, the flaws in the film. It's enjoyable as you go through it. The story's there, the setup's there, and sort of middle ground professionalism works because the cast really deliver. But it's like one of those ones is like you could remake this with another cast with a better director and it would be much better. And just cast the lead character better. That's the main thing is thing I think about this film most of all is why'd they cast James Corden? He's terrible. I really want to like this film a lot more than I do because there's so much good stuff in it. Emily Blunt's terrific in it. Anna Kendrick's terrific in it. Like Chris Pine's hilarious in it. But Corden's terrible. It just is the problem. That's a real problem. But I'll move off from that. So I hope you enjoyed these Go watch Sweeney Todd and West Side Story. Into the Woods, it's more of an iffy thing, but it's still worth a watch. Just, you know, prepare for James Corden when not very good. Right, so that's my video. I hope you enjoyed it, and I'll be back with some more soon. Right, bye for now.